All right. Good morning, everyone. Since we do have a packed agenda, we are going to go ahead and get started. So my name is Fabian Fuentes, and I am the Grants and Contracts Coordinator at Within Reach. I use he, him pronouns, and on behalf of the Within Reach WCOMO planning team, we would like you to welcome you all to our 18th fully virtual WCOMO meeting. To provide context and background for those of you who may not have joined us before, the Washington Coalition on Medicaid Outreach, also known as WCOMO, brings together community-based organizations and state agencies to share information about Medicaid outreach strategies, as well as healthcare reform so that more people in Washington can access healthcare and meet their healthcare needs. With the support of our partners at the Department of Social and Health Services, the Health Benefit Exchange, and the Healthcare Authority, we work to convene these meetings on a quarterly basis to share important updates, practices, and learnings with you all. Thank you all so much for being here today, especially for our presenters for taking the time to come and share important information with us. And a huge shout out to Jessica for managing our slide deck. So we would also like to give a special thank you to our 2024 WCOMO meeting sponsors. That includes WellPoint, Molina Healthcare, Coordinated Care, United Healthcare, and Arcora. So thank you for partnering with us and supporting these 2024 meetings. All right, and then here is a snapshot of today's agenda. We'll have presenters from Within Reach, the Washington State Department of Social and Health Services, Washington Health Benefit Exchange, the Washington State Healthcare Authority, Coordinated Care, and WellPoint. And we do have a few housekeeping items to go over. First up is Zoom. I'm sure we are all quite familiar with Zoom at this point, but just wanted to touch on a few things. So as for the audio, we will be keeping all of our attendees muted during today's meeting. And for your video, having your video is optional. The focus of your screen will be the presentations and the presenters. So for all who are attending today, if you are comfortable and able, we do encourage you to turn on your video. And the chat box and questions, we will be using the chat box for all attendee questions during today's meeting. That applies to both technology and presentation-related questions. And we do ask that you all hold all of your presentation-related questions until the end of that given presentation. We will make it through as many attendee questions as possible, but of course, if we are short on time and unable to get to everyone, we will follow up with folks after the meeting is over. And a quick note about self-care. We of course encourage all of our attendees to manage your needs during today's meeting. So please take breaks as needed, and please don't feel like you're going to miss out on anything if you do step away, because we are going to be recording this meeting and all of the presentations from today will be posted online, so you won't miss out on anything. All right, and it is now officially time for us to dive into the content of today's meeting. So first up, we are going to have Within Reach updates from Karina Wiggins, Bea Babita, and Fabiola Rubalcaba. And Karina is our Director of Coordinated Access, and Fee and Fabiola are both resource and outreach navigators. So with that being said, I'll go ahead and hand it over to them.
Thanks so much, Fabienne. Good morning, everyone. Happy Friday. We made it through another week. Thanks for having us today. This particular topic on our community connections team may feel a little bit familiar. Some of it will be a bit of a refresher from our last meeting in June, but I know that was a little while ago. So this also might feel like new information. We've had a new team join at Within Reach in partnership with Healthier Here for supporting families and individuals within King County who are navigating health-related social needs. So you can move to the next slide and I'll go over our agenda. So this was funded through the Medicaid Transformation Project. I'll do a brief overview of what that entails and how that connects to us. I'll also be reviewing what it looks like within King County for hub coordination of case management services. We'll be going over what the referral process looks like, as well as services offered and how this is an extension of our Help Me Grow Washington initiative. And then, of course, at the end, there'll be opportunity for you all to ask questions. So the Medicaid Transformation Project, this was awarded to the state of Washington last year. It is a 5-year contract in whole, and that body of work is funding a variety of different services that you see in those hexagon shapes on the screen. Where we'll be focusing on today is primarily that centralized gold color area where we have had the opportunity with Healthier Here to be a part of their community hub in King County. There are hubs across Washington State, but as we were, kind of ending pandemic funding in partnership with Healthier Here to serve families in King County who were navigating COVID-related needs. This was sort of the next step to continue to maintain that infrastructure and provide case management services to anyone who might be interested in Medicaid, but also anyone who has other needs as well. So folks don't necessarily have to be Medicaid eligible to be able to participate in this program. Essentially, they need to be having some kind of health-related social need, whether that be housing, health insurance, basic food, parenting support. You'll hear a little bit more of what those services look like in a bit, and how Within Reach specializes in supporting families within the community hub in King County. So this graphic might be a bit of a refresher to folks. This is how community members enter the Healthier Here community hub and what happens once a referral is made. So in just a bit here, I'll put the electronic referral form. If you know of families or individuals who may be interested in this kind of service, you are welcome to make referrals, and we encourage you to make a referral through Within Reach. And I'll share that link in just a bit. But essentially, what happens is someone in the community, either a community-based organization, a healthcare provider, somebody who has contact with an individual or family who may need access to longer-term resources, makes a referral to the Healthier Here community hub through an electronic referral form. And what happens at that point is based on the information that's provided, the language needs of that family or individual, the specialization of services that that person might need, Healthier Here reviews that document and pairs that family or individual with the best organization within their hub model to support that family. So, for example, within Reach and within our Help Me Grow structure, we specialize in serving families with young children. We also have a number of bilingual staff on our case management team. And so, depending on the needs of that individual or family, they may get matched with us as the case management partner and then placed directly with a resource navigator on our team, who you'll hear from just a bit from V and Fabiola. And those navigators will then process the referral and determine what the needs of that family might be and what might be most helpful. This is a non-time limited program. So families or individuals can be a part of this program for as long as they want, and as long as they're able to connect with that resource navigator on a regular basis in a virtual structure. You can go to the next slide.
So the process for referral distribution kind of goes in this order. Us, the resource and outreach navigators, we receive the referrals and we contact clients to be able to screen them and kind of assess and identify what their needs are. So we work with them closely, we do an assessment, we kind of set goals with them, and then we work to try and connect them to those resources. We're trying to find resources that are actually available. We're really working hard to try and eliminate those like dead ends that clients have when they're trying to connect resources. So trying to make sure that the resources we connect them to are actually available with current funding. And then something that's different, like I think maybe you know about our Help Me Grow and how we have a hotline of people who are able to connect clients to resources as well. The difference is that the hotline is more of a one-touch program, and we are able to actually work with clients longer term. So we're able to follow up with them, complete warm handoffs when necessary, just like build more of a relationship, build rapport with them. And then obviously we are documenting all of our notes because we need those notes to be able to ensure that the program is assisting clients in the best way possible. And then obviously like a big thing that Community Connections is doing is trying to build a really strong network of providers who are able to collaborate with each other and really help our community get to the resources that they need. So that is Community Connections. And this is a new program, so we're really working and building it out as we go.
Great. So some of the services we offer to families and individuals across King County kind of differ, but some of them are access to improving food security, access to child development support, family stability support, adult and pediatrics access, and then as well as all of our navigators are trained to help individuals with either their health application for insurance, also basic food if they're needing help or assistance with that. We're all trained to do that as well as getting clients connected to WIC, housing navigation, and also mental and behavioral navigation. It's all based on case by case, so it's all dependent on like what the household or individuals are needing. We'll get sometimes clients that are looking for access to like maybe like a lawyer or access to maybe like food delivery system or food delivery, which was something that we offered before, but we no longer offer, but we'll reach out to our network and look for other resources that we can connect clients to. So an example that I've used a lot has been United Way. They deliver food for clients, so we can get clients on an intake form for that, or we'll just reach out to other agencies in the hub or do our research and help. Try to help our clients as much as we can.
So yeah, I briefly mentioned that our program is kind of like this is similar to Help Me Grow Hotline. We're kind of an extension of that. Right now, that's a big thing that we're doing is we're outreaching to past Help Me Grow clients because, like I said, Help Me Grow Hotline is a one touch. So they're not actually capable of following up and like finding out if the client, if the resources that they provided to the client, if the client was actually able to access that. So we are reaching out to them and just trying to make sure that that like no one falls beneath into the cracks, so that if they try to access resources for the hotline and they weren't able to, that we're connecting with them again, and we're still trying to make sure that they get those resources and that connection.
Well, thank you so much, everyone, for hearing this brief presentation about our Community Connections work. I'm sure that as we continue together, you'll hear more about the benefit of having this longer-term case management service available to families as an extension of our Help Me Grow Washington work. And please feel free to put any questions in the chat, or you're welcome to go off mute at this time. I'll stay on for a little while here if there are particular questions that would be helpful to have answered. I also put a link in the chat to our online referral form and would encourage you to refer folks our way who may be in need of this longer-term case management assistance. Thanks, everyone.
All right. I don't see any questions in the chat, but folks are more than welcome to drop any in there. But I do want to say thank you all so much for the three of you for sharing information about community connections. Appreciate you for having you here today. So next up, we have Mario Paduano here from the
Sorry, I'm
Washington.
so sorry. I couldn't get off mute because I'm not used to Zoom on my
Oh.
Teams. I was like, where's the mute button?
Oh, no
And I
worries.
apologize if you covered this already. How many languages do you serve?
Great question. So right now on our team in particular, we primarily have Spanish bilingual speakers. We also use a translation service that serves folks with over 250 different language options. And then within the network, we have a variety of languages that are spoken by other case management partners. So if for example, if our team can't meet that language need, Healthier Here will review specialists from other agencies to see who might be able to meet the need of that family or individual.
Thank you so much.
All righty. Good morning, everyone. My name is Mario Paduano. I am the area's Region 2 Financial and Training Coordinator. Always pleased to be here. Fabian, thank you so much for being flexible in terms of the agenda and getting you the slides and just working with me in general, which may or may not be a pleasure. I make you answer that, but I appreciate working with you, and I'm always happy to be here and present some DSHS updates from the Community Services Division. And don't have a lot for you today, but do have some stuff that you might find useful. So on the next slide, I want to let everyone know that previously, if a client reported an address change to us and they did not include their new rent amount or their new mortgage amount, due to rules from the USDA, we would reach out to that client and say, hey, what's your new rent and mortgage? And if the client did not reply, we would be forced to zero out or delete any shelter costs that were previously coded on the case. And the end result of that is often that benefits were reduced. I'm happy to report that we received another waiver from the USDA allowing us to not do that. So if a client reports their address change, it's always useful to include what the new rent or mortgage amount is, in particular, if your rent or mortgage has increased. Your rent and mortgage has increased. We want to know about it, whether you've moved or not, because it could increase your benefits. Now, are you required to report that? No. Is it to your benefit to report it? Yes. So increases in shelter costs are definitely useful for us to know about, in particular, because client benefits can increase. The change here, however, is pretty simple and a good one for our clients insofar as if we find out or get a report of an address change and rent or mortgage for the new residence has not been included, we no longer have to zero out those shelter costs. The shelter costs will remain the same. And then at the next review, at the 6 month or 1 year mark, we'll go ahead and ask you and then update it at that time. So good news there. Definitely helps our clients vis-a-vis reporting address changes. Next, there is a change to our basic food work registration rules. Now, these rules only apply to able-bodied adults without dependents. You may hear them called ABODs. We love our acronyms. But in general, if someone is able-bodied between certain ages and able to work, and they don't have any dependents in their household, the expectation is that they will work or participate in work-like activities a certain amount each month to maintain their basic food benefits. If they do not meet those criteria, they are permitted 3 months of basic food benefits. Those months do not have to be consecutive. And once those 3 months have been utilized, benefits close until that person meets the requirements in the future. So starting on October 1st, ABODs who are 18 to 54 years old may be subject to work requirements. So the change here is it used to be 52, now it is 54, and this is the result of the most recent agriculture bill that passed Congress. Now, of course, these rules only apply to ABODs who do not meet an exemption from work requirements. And on the next screen, I believe I posted or listed a few of the exemptions. If someone is homeless, if someone is living outside of King County, if someone is participating in Work First, if someone is on unemployment compensation, LNI compensation, and there are other exceptions, so those folks who meet those exceptions would not need to worry about this rule. If there's a dependent in the household, if they're a full-time student, it just kind of goes on and on and on. And it becomes a pretty complex process. But nonetheless, just because you're between 18 and 54 and getting basic food benefits, that doesn't mean you fall into this group or category. You also have a series of criteria that could exempt you from those rules. And those include the ones you see on their screen. And there are many more. And indeed, any client who may or may not fall into this category, when they receive their approval letters, there will be listed an entire list of exemptions to this rule. And so just want to let you know, just because you're between 18 and 54 now, doesn't necessarily mean you fall or have to follow these rules, but you might. And you want to go ahead and check the letter or the approval letter we sent you, and it's got those rules on there. On the next screen, we have, again, just kind of general review of these rules. Many of you have heard of these before. In particular, if you're in King County, you've probably heard of these. For those of you outside King County, they haven't applied outside of King County for a number of years. That doesn't mean they won't in the future, but as of right now, they don't. But again, you must meet an exception criteria if you're an ABOD, and if you're not participating in work or work-like activities, your benefits are limited to 3 months. Those benefits can begin again if they have been stopped, but only once you begin to meet those requirements. And the good news is ABOTs can participate in what we call workfare. We have workfare sites. And if a client volunteers at one of those sites or volunteers in their community, as long as they're doing a certain number of hours each month and we'll ask for a verification each month, their benefits will continue. So it could be work or work-like activities. Vis-a-vis volunteerism. I've gone down a rabbit hole here. The main thing you need to know is ages 52 to 54 are now included in those rules. Something I'm particularly excited to share with everyone as the legislator has refunded this. If someone is participating in Work First, and this is our work readiness program that is connected to our TANF and SFA program, if someone's participating in Work First, we have what are called support services. These support services are additional supports that help people either get jobs or maintain jobs. So as an example, let's say I got a job offer, but my car is broken down and I need to get to that job. Support services may be able to help you get that car repaired. Let's say my license was revoked because I didn't pay a ticket. We may be able to help you there too. Let's say you got a job in nursing, but you don't have the right clothing, or you got a job at a laboratory somewhere and you need some gear or a construction site, et cetera, et cetera. If you need something that will help you get or keep a job, this program can help. But one of the things we never had before until last year were housing supports. And we were often asked, I need housing supports. And we often, unfortunately, didn't have a whole lot we could offer, but now we do. These housing supports can help TANF workforce participants pay their rent, mortgage, taxes, all the things you see on your screen, moving, temporary housing if needed, pet fees if you have to pay them, anything housing related that will in turn facilitate or empower that family to engage in work or maintain their jobs, we can help. So if anybody here knows any family that is on TANF and needs an assist with housing supports, have them reach out to their case manager or go into the office, or they can call the call center. Now our call center, while they can give them the information, they can't directly issue the supports for support services, but nonetheless, they can at least gather some information and give some information to the client and give them next steps. I think the easiest thing for our customers to do is reach out to your case manager, say, hey, having trouble paying the rent, I'm behind, you know, I just got a job, but if I have to move, I can't keep this job, whatever the rationale is. And then that case manager can see whether or not we may be able to help with housing. And again, housing is expensive, as we all know, in particular in King, Snohomish, Pierce, everywhere now. So I encourage everyone to let our shared customers know about this if you believe they would benefit. And Janeth, could you put that little Q&A document that we were given, a link to it in the chat? And we can hand that, we can distribute that as well. And it's got some additional information on there. Next, we've got a customer outreach campaign coming and it's going over the phone. And so starting this month, basic food customers, they might receive a reminder phone call regarding income limits and reporting requirements for the program. So I wanted to share these with you because you might very well get that question. I got a job. Do I have to report it? I got a raise. Do I have to report it? And the answer, as with many of our programs, is it depends. Well, one of the things that the federal government came and they did an audit and they realized that we had a number of customers who weren't able or weren't knowledgeable about those rules enough to ensure that they wouldn't receive what are called overpayments, which is essentially when you get either more or less benefits than you were entitled to, and was causing a number of errors on cases. And so the federal government said, hey, we'd like you to do something about it. And so this is part of what we're doing. So again, this campaign was created and was initiated to prevent inaccurate benefit issuances and was in response to a federal directive. So who's gonna get these calls? This is a little complicated, you don't have to remember it, but there's only a certain subset of basic food customers who are going to receive these calls. That subset is those customers that are required to complete a mid-certification review, receive benefits that are greater than $290 a month, and reported no income at their most recent review, or have two household members or more that are over 22 years old, with the exception of households without shelter or homeless households. So if someone happens to fall in that category, they may get one of these phone calls. Now on the next slide, I want to put people's kind of concerns at rest and kind of review what the rules are. So for basic food, we've got two thresholds at which a customer needs to report an increase in income. So if a household has an income increase above 130% of the federal poverty limit, once that occurs, they need to let us know. Now, for those households that are already above 130%, if their income goes over 200% of the federal poverty limit, they also need to let us know. And they need to let us know by the 10th of the month following when the change occurred. So if I get a new job, say I get a new job in September, but I don't get that first paycheck until October. It's now November 10th when I need to report the change, because that is the 10th of the month following when my income actually changed. And of course, at every review, you want to report and let us know of any income changes. So now you're probably asking yourself, self, what is 130%, 200% of the federal poverty limit? And how would I ever know that? Well, on the next slide, I will give you some examples. So the first one is on your approval letter. So clients get an approval letter. It's a good idea to hold on to it. I totally understand if you don't. I can't remember the last thing I held on to that I got in the mail for very long. But, and if I do, it's a big stack. And I look at that stack and I think to myself, you gotta throw some of that away and act on it. And it just kind of builds. So, but approval letters, don't be Mario, don't be like me. Keep that approval letter. And in your approval letter, it'll tell you when you need to report in the amount. So this is an example, household of five. Thank you, Janeth. Household of five. This household would need to report if their gross monthly income in any given month from all sources is over $3,807. So first you can look on the approval letter on the next slide. We've got some other ways that you can know when you need to report. You can go to Washington Connection, has all the information there. You could visit an office. You could call the call center. And what's nice is that the very first person you speak to will be able to give you this information. You will not need to wait on hold for a long time. You will not need to sit in our lobby for however, you know, depending on how busy it is, it can be an hour or two. The very first person you talk to, you can say, hey, I got a job. Do I have to report it? And then they'll let you know what the income limits are. And then you can say, oh, I don't have to, or yes, I do. And then we'll take that information from you. So again, I wouldn't know what 130% of the federal poverty limit is if I didn't have this job. And do I have it memorized? Of course not. I always have to look it up. And so there are ways for our customers to do it as well. So again, they're on our letters. It's at Washington Connection. And of course, you can always visit us or call our call center, and we're happy to give you that information. Now, going back to the campaign on the next slide, I've got some frequently asked questions. Oh, also, let me put this in there. How can you report changes? All of the bullet points you see on your screen are access points, if you will, to report changes. So if you do discover that your income change has happened and it puts your household, gross monthly household, over 130 or 200%, you visit an office, call the call center. You can report that change on Washington Connection. You could fax us. That's right. We take faxes still. You could fax us, email us, mail us, drop it off at the Dropbox. Man, we'll take that information any way it comes. And there's all those access points. So please utilize those, whatever's most convenient for you and your customers. Going back to the campaign, I've got a little frequently asked question here. So I'm not sure if it's Fabian or another person doing the slides, but your space bar is going to give those answers. So if I receive this message, does this mean I must report my current income? No. Just because someone got the message does not mean they have to report their income. It only means they need to report their income if it's a reminder that if it's gone above a certain limit, then yes, they do need to report it. If I receive this message, does this mean you think my income has increased? The answer to that is no. These calls are just reminders. They are not triggered by specific income information that we received through third parties or through our cross-match system that we utilize. So again, just because you get the call doesn't mean you have to report your income, and it doesn't mean we think your income has increased. It's just a reminder. When do these phone calls begin? They begin on the fourth business day, and they're going to continue until the entire target audience has been reached. And one more question, if I meet the criteria to receive these calls, when can I expect them? They're going to come between month 6 and month 12 of your certification review. And so once you've gone past that mid-certification part of your certification period, which happens around month 6, that until the end, you might receive these calls. And again, just because you receive a call doesn't mean you have to report your income. It's just a reminder. And it doesn't mean we have any information that may or may not that your income has gone up. It's just they're just reminder phone calls. And finally, the ultimate last reminder is if your income has decreased or you have lost your job, just like if your shelter costs have increased, you want to let us know. Are you required to let us know if you lose your job? Of course not. Would it make your benefits go up? Probably would, depending on who you are and some other factors. So if your household income decreases, definitely let us know that. And with that, I have gone over time, hopefully not too far. You've got our email addresses on the screen. I know Andy Sam is on the line. Our Spend Down Master of Disaster, our Spend Down Jedi. You're now the Spend Down Jedi, Andy. And with that, I don't know if I have time for questions. I will leave it to Fabian to decide. And I'll get Janet. I see your message, and I'll find it for you. It's not a Q&A. It's that one document that we sent on First Friday. Sorry for taking up your time.
Awesome, thanks, Mario. I do see one question. If you have time to answer that real quick,
certainly do.
And the question is: for elderly population who only receive SSA/SSI incomes, will they receive this phone call?
I would need to review the specific requirements. Trying to think. Arguably, they might, but if you are somebody who is on a fixed income, if you are on a fixed income and you are on either SSI or Social Security income, be it disability or retirement, we will always know of your income changes. The federal government interfaces with our system and the changes happen behind the scenes and they happen automatically. Would that exempt you from a phone call? I don't know, but what I can tell you is the likelihood you would have to report is low because we'll know about it already. So I want to say I'm not sure, but if someone is on a fixed income and that income is from Social Security, a federal source like that, we'll know about any changes. And so the need to report is probably not there. So that's not a great answer. I don't feels like Friday the 13th in so many ways. Is Mercury in retrograde? Someone more astrologically inclined than me, because it feels like something's up. But thank you.
Cool. And then I guess for the sake of time, I guess we will proceed. But there is one more question in the chat. If you are able to answer that, Mario, that'd be greatly appreciated. And Perfect. So, yeah. And so next, we will transition to our next presenter. This is Alex Johnson from the Washington Health Benefit Exchange. And Alex is the Senior Navigator Program Specialist and will be sharing updates.
Great. Thank you, Fabian. Is everyone able to hear my audio okay? Just want to make sure I'm ringing through clear.
Yep.
All right. Awesome. So I'm Alex Johnson. I am the Senior Navigator Program Specialist for the Navigator Program at the Exchange. And we're just here, very grateful to be in attendance, sharing information, some important relevant updates that we thought you all should partake in. So please feel free to move to the next slide, and I'm happy to provide the content. Our first updates are going to be around open enrollment 12. We wanted to go over some marketing and communications developments and how we're approaching the work. So these are our challenges and opportunities. We wanted to notate that it is always good to create a sense of urgency. So we're going over the federal tax credits, and 2025 currently set is the last year of enhanced federal credits. The math around that is going to be the premium prices, how that has a detriment if those don't continue on. SLCSP, second lowest cost silver plan, and then Cascade Care Savings, which has been implemental in addressing the affordability barriers. Inflation is another focal point, which has an impact to households. And then the assistance, which is the financial assistance and the assister and navigator partner networks. So we're really addressing the situation as a whole and working to find affordability barriers and how to best address everything. This was the statewide campaign, and there were some key themes that were identified, such as trust, accessibility, simplicity, healthy living, and then just being genuine. We do have some more long-winded sentences on it. You can feel free to access on the slides, but really these key benefits, especially related to being trustworthy, direct communications. So our communication to our customers, we try to be quick and concise and avoid confusions and then provide value for that. And then just being authentic, that authenticity with the challenges that have came, trying to find the right health plan and be there to guide the customers and support the people that we serve. This is our marketing approach. You can see, first off, I'd like to highlight that the individuals in these pictures are actual Washingtonians. They are people who inhabit the state. We found that that would give a very authentic approach to our marketing to the people that actually are affected and live in the state of Washington. We are taking a minimalist approach with font. Noto Sans is the font that we have highlighted in our direct strategic communications outreaches. And then we just try to, you know, have very focal pointed words with not too much business going across. So daily activities, you can see families that are either single or diverse, and really the people that we serve, which is a diverse population, ethnically, religiously, affiliation wise, in a whole. So we try to encompass everybody, and that's been the approach. We do have some short messages that I would like to provide. Your health, our priority, is our statement for this marketing campaign. And so really some things that really have traction on what our core values are. Embrace life. When it comes to health and dental insurance, we have the perfect plan for you. I'm just highlighting a couple of these. Your health, our priority. And really, from a simplistic standpoint, that's just our way of notating. We're here to advocate and bridge the barriers for healthcare, which is essential to daily life and a quality of life. And it is our priority, which we see through partnering with our sisters, or really getting involved in boots on the ground ways of having people know about the coverage in a way that's not daunting or overwhelming as well. And then also the savings side of it, exclusive savings with the perfect health and dental insurance plans. Because, you know, as we have rolled out Cascade Care Savings and different tax credit allotments, we still understand and recognize a huge ability and continues to be one of our main things that we want to address. And here's some long messages, just some bulleted points. I can go ahead and read one of them. Washington Health Plan Finder, make shopping for the right plan easy, because finding the perfect health plan shouldn't be a chore. And I'll stop there on that one. It's just what's been found is not just the accessibility of healthcare or plan shopping or access to savings. How is the process streamlined? Is it overwhelming? We essentially want to make it to the point where people in the community don't find it daunting or anxiety ridden to shop for care or have access to a qualified navigator or a sister who can direct them with the right plan options and savings for them. And this is the 2024 multicultural campaign approach. So the statewide multicultural awareness campaign with a similar scope and tactics to our addressments. It's got digital and interviews as well on there. It's really been found that we really want to expand efforts to generate additional content. It's definitely through social presences as well, which you can see there. It talks about Facebook and Instagram. And then connected TV and radio ads are very essential as well. But really understanding the social and digital culture of today and trying to find ways to reach targeted people who are online for various reasons and make sure that we have access to them and are very clear in our messages as well. Our next section, I really want to go over some enhanced federal subsidies. Try to go not too much into the weed, but talk about how they've been a benefit and what the potential impact could be with some of those that are dwindling or going away. Thank you. So here's a quick synopsis background on enhanced federal subsidies. They're also known as advanced premium tax credits. We shorten them here, APTCs. And they're a federal tax credit that it helps offset some of that cost of the premium for exchange customers. I want to highlight some of the information we have provided here. So ARPA, the enhanced federal subsidies starting in 2021, eligible customers under 400% FPL, they were able to receive a larger APTC amount. And then what really had a benefit is we had some customers become eligible for these federal subsidies at the over 400% FPL percentage for the first time. That was groundbreaking. And it was a way to continue to address affordability barriers in different tax brackets and try and make medical not so much of a detriment to everyday affordability barrier life for Washingtonians. Enhanced federal subsidies are set to expire currently in December of 2025 under current law. So we are working very diligently in tandem across our teams here to try and address that, brace for potential impacts as well. And so some of these supposed impacts that we could feel, and this is the impact of ARPA enhanced federal subsidies. Right now, more than 253,000 customers in these qualified health plans, otherwise known as a QHP, through Washington Health Plan Finder. So that's the impact we have. That's up 20% from 2023. So not really a huge amount of time has gone by, and we've seen a 20% growth. Nearly 80% of our qualified health plan customers do qualify for federal subsidies. Again, that's up 61% before ARPA was initiated. That is a massive impact in a positive way as we continue to address these affordability barriers On average, we were able to break it down. These customers save over $400 per member per month on their premiums. So that's per member. I want to highlight that. If there's families of four and five, you multiply that. And that is such a groundbreaking way to help save people on these premiums monthly and have them have less of an impact from an affordability standpoint. The loss of ARPA-enhanced subsidies. So here's some other projections. 55,000 projected enrollment decrease. That's individuals who would now no longer have an enrollment through the exchange and would either have to not have coverage or have coverage elsewhere somehow. So that's $250 million projected decrease in APTC. That's the tax credits. And that is not a minimal amount, $250 million projected decrease. So the impact will be felt by age, income, location, race, and ethnicity. And another highlight, people who have major health needs. Maybe they have an ongoing medical need that they need health coverage for. Individuals who have that effect and can no longer have that affordability with the loss of ARPA would potentially feel that impact as well. So currently we're responding with education about enhanced subsidies. That's through working with our stakeholders, through presentations such as this, through talking in the community, really working with people who have knowledge or lack thereof as well on what these subsidies provide for our customers, the way that it helps the people have coverage, and really what losing these subsidies would cause a detriment to. It's also exploring policy options for mitigating the impact. How can we circumnavigate this collectively if we do lose the subsidies? What can we do to change policy options and then help address affordability? And then also, very importantly, preparing for the impact on exchange business operations. So that means bracing for potential impacts, for decrease in enrollments, for affordability issues to rise, really trying to find and strategize ahead of time in case these things matriculate. I did want to provide some quick other updates before we move on as well to the next presenter. So open enrollment readiness. Here's our open enrollment information, assister support information, Cascade Care plans, partner outreach toolkit, carrier plan, and then tips and tricks. So if there's anything else added, we're receptive to that as well. We're working on our OE readiness to make sure that resources are available for people accessing that plan page with the most up-to-date information and PDFs and slides as well. Our carrier resources and LMS, this page will also include carrier week presentations and resources for plan year 2025. That's us making sure everything down to the Apple Health Managed Care Plan or Managed Care Plan invoice and expectation charts are updated for the 2025 plan year with accurate links for access of information that is current and up to date based on current trends and regulations. Open enrollment reports. So we did just want to talk about this because customers that have been auto-renewed into a plan year or 2025 or customers that need to manually renew into a plan year, we are going to be providing these open enrollment reports for lead orgs. It goes into submitting an application as well, selecting a plan, binder payments, and then Cascade Care savings as information presented. Customers with a federal poverty level up to 250% that are not currently enrolled into a Cascade Silver or Gold plan. Just wanted to highlight that as well. So Pacific Source exiting Washington State update. So Pacific Source will no longer offer health insurance in the state of Washington. That means individuals and families enrolled with Pacific Source for plan year 2024, they were notified in outreach in July that their current health and dental plans will no longer be offered for plan year 2025. The last day of validity for those plans is December 31st, 2024. If a client has health and dental insurance through those plans, they'll automatically be moved into a new plan starting January 1st, if not selected. The client will be informed in the end of 2024 October time of what plan they have been auto-enrolled. And then from November 1st through January 15th, the client can then switch plans. So during that time, definitely recommended to check with doctor networks and providers and make sure that the plan they were selected for is accepted, or else they'll be able to switch during that time period as well. Okay, so here's our open enrollment outreach timeline. The application deadline had passed. That was September 6th. The community-based organization selection slated for mid-September around now, and then community-based organization boarding is late October. The funds distributed late October as well, and then all of that outreach and engagement is going to be through the November period through January, so essentially open enrollment during the critical pivotal times of customer correspondences. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact Kelly Aaron, our Navigator Support Manager. There's her drop-down email, or you can contact myself, Alex Johnson, the Senior Navigator Program Specialist, at these emails. We are happy to answer any questions, address any concerns, or topics that you want to see brought up or discussed. Please feel free to connect with us. And then to stay informed, you can sign up at that drop-down here link to receive regular updates from WABI. We're happy to provide any insight. And also, if you have any questions now, feel free to direct them to me, and I'll do my best to either answer them or connect with an internal team who can best support that question and roundtable back out to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alex.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I will. I don't see any questions in the chat, but I will invite folks to drop any in there. And we'll ask if you are available to stay on for a little bit to answer those if any do come in.
Absolutely.
Awesome. That'd be amazing.
Thank you.
Yeah. And so with that, for our next presenter, we have Shawnee Cousins here from the Washington State Healthcare Authority. And Shawnee is with the Office of Medicaid Eligibility Policy at the Healthcare Authority and will be sharing updates with us.
Hello, it's great to be here. I am Shawnee Cousins, and I am with, we've changed our section's name. So we're now the Eligibility Policy Innovation and Community Support Team. Same team, same function, just new name. And we will go ahead and just dive in. We have some healthcare authority updates to share with you. We will talk a little bit about Apple Health expansion. We also have information about after pregnancy coverage. We would also like to highlight our voices of Apple Health and then leave you today with some resources. All right, let's get into our updates. Again, just as I said, our team name has changed. And along with that team name change, we've also moved to a different division. We are now part of the IT Innovation and Customer Experience Administration at the Healthcare Authority. We would also like to let everyone know that if you have Apple Health policy questions, our team can now be reached at hcaahEligibilityPolicy@hca.wa.gov. Next slide, please. We have been working really hard over the last several months to provide quarterly Apple Health webinars. These webinars are pre-recorded and include time afterwards for you to ask questions on the topic of the webinar. We recommend that if you're interested, you sign up. If you're not able to attend, those sessions are posted on our HCA stakeholder and training webpage. If you have not yet subscribed to HCA's Gov Delivery, if you do so, we do share information about the webinars, including the topics that are covered, as well as the date and time of each webinar. We provide information that is a great opportunity to train newly hired assisters or other individuals who assist clients with their Apple Health, or as a refresher for those of you who have even been doing this for a while. So really recommend signing up for those if you haven't. Next slide, please. We are always looking for recommendations for Apple Health webinar topics. So if you have any thoughts, please send them our way. There's that email address again. And also just for your information, our final Apple Health quarterly webinar for 2024 will be on December 5th. We do have the link that is available to you for your opportunity to register for these webinars. If you go to hca.wa.gov/stakeholder-training, you can select choose webinars, videos, and presentations, and then you can register for any of those. And it is here you'll also find those pre-recorded webinars that we've held in the past. Next slide, please. All right, so another update we have for you is about our federal poverty level increase. SSB 550 directed Healthcare Authority to increase the income limit from 193% of the federal poverty level to 210% by November 1st. And that will be effective for Apple Health for pregnant individuals, as well as after pregnancy coverage. If you're interested in learning more about that bill, we do have a link available in the slide for you to visit. Next slide, please. All right, we are going to talk a little bit today about Apple Health expansion. Next slide, thank you. Just to provide an update on the enrollment cap status, on June 20th of this year, HCA began to enroll individuals who are eligible for Apple Health expansion, and that coverage began for those individuals July 1st. The enrollment limit for Apple Health expansion has since been met. The enrollment cap was met for the MAGI Medicaid on June 21st, and then for Classic Medicaid on July 3rd. Currently, HCA has been working on several Apple Health expansion implementation areas. Those include ensuring that those who've been approved for Apple Health expansion are able to stay connected to the program, consistent with our current Apple Health policies. So again, this program is intended to mirror traditional Apple Health programs. Also through creating short and long-term policies to support ongoing enrollment. And then the agency will also explore long-term enrollment solutions, and these are IT dependent. So there are those types of factors that are in consideration. So looking at something similar to a wait list. And we will continue to provide updates to the community as we progress forward with all of these initiatives. Next slide, thank you. All right, let's talk a little bit about Apple Health expansion eligibility. Apple Health expansion is available to Washington residents who are age 19 years and older, who have an income at or below 138% of the federal poverty level. Here we have just a quick reference chart that shows you household size relative to the 138%. Individuals who have eligibility and access to other Apple Health programs based on their immigration status, and those who are eligible for qualified health plans and receive advanced premium tax credits or federally funded medical programs are not eligible for Apple Health expansion. Next slide, please. Individuals who don't qualify for the federally subsidized healthcare coverage because of immigration status may continue to qualify for other Apple Health programs, such as medical care services, alien emergency medical, and then of course the Apple Health for pregnant individuals, after pregnancy coverage, and always Apple Health for kids. Next slide, please. All right, let's talk a little bit about the program being at capacity. With the enrollment cap being met, individuals who apply for Apple Health expansion currently will receive a denial. Those individuals can still apply for programs such as emergency medical and can be approved if they have a qualifying condition and meet that eligibility criteria. As if individuals are denied in Washington Health Plan Finder because of the enrollment cap, they'll receive an eligibility notice with other healthcare options. Also, clients under 250% are eligible for Cascade Care Savings if they enroll in a Cascade Care plan. So just trying to ensure that there's some, you know, we're doing what we can to provide coverage options to these individuals who would otherwise be eligible if the enrollment cap was not full. Next slide, please. We would also encourage individuals to continue applying even though the cap is currently met. Those who apply and are denied due to that specific reason still have an opportunity for random selection to be enrolled if a space becomes available in the program. there would be no additional steps they need to take beyond applying and being approved for the program. And they would receive an eligibility notice through whatever their preferred communication method is, email or mail, if they are selected at that random time for enrollment. And again, that's if spaces become available throughout the year. All right. Individuals should also work to keep their application updated, making sure that they include any information changes to their household, whether it's income, ensuring that their contact information is up to date so that they can receive notifications if they are selected for enrollment. And then if people are unsure if they've applied for coverage, they can contact Washington Health Plan Finder customer support to verify their application if they are age 19 to 64. And for those who are age 65 and over, they can contact the Department of Social and Health Services, or they can visit their local community services office for information. Next slide. We do have a lot of community resources available to help provide more information to everyone about Apple Health expansion. So we do have this great communications toolkit. It includes client publications, branding and language guidance, a social media toolkit. So for those of you who might like to use the communications that we've pre-created and approved for Apple Health expansion, this is available at hca.wa.gov. And there is a link available in this slide. I think I saw that you would will receive these slides after. Also, there will be future updates, including updates to the key messages that we are working to communicate through this plan, as well as keeping social media content updated and provide previews of letters that are generated and sent to Apple Health Expansion clients. Next slide. This is just an example of our updated social media. So we do have several different posts that have been created, and those can be downloaded through the social media toolkit along with other images that are available for this program. Next slide, please. We do have a number of Apple Health Expansion webinars that are available at our stakeholder training page. So if you are interested in learning more, you can find these webinars, these ones are posted at Apple Health Expansion page. It is similar to the webinar page through the stakeholder training page, but here you can find the presentation slides translated, also accompanying FAQs, as well as the recorded version of the webinar itself. HCA is also looking for feedback on experiences applying for Apple Health expansion. If you have applied for or you've helped someone apply for Apple Health expansion, we are hoping that you would be willing to complete the survey that we will use to help improve our future efforts. The survey is open through September 20th, and we do have it available in English and Spanish. Next slide, please. We have added an Apple Health Expansion Gov Delivery topic to our Gov Delivery service. If you have either not subscribed to Gov Delivery or you have not subscribed to Apple Health Expansion within the Gov Delivery platform, we highly recommend you do that. We share a lot of important updates and information through Gov Delivery. Next slide, thank you. We do have some Apple Health Expansion specific resources, including our client-facing webpage. We have our stakeholder webpage that's available, as well as information on our Apple Health for Non-Citizens page. And then we do have a copy of our enrollment cap announcement that is available as well. Next slide. Thank you. All right, we will jump right into after pregnancy coverage. Prior to the expansion of postpartum coverage that happened back in 2022, pregnant people on Apple Health received 60 days of postpartum coverage that began the month after their pregnancy ended. And then after that 60-day postpartum coverage, transitioned to 10 months of family planning only pregnancy-related coverage. So this was a limited scope benefit package that included contraceptive care and planning-related services only. Next slide. In 2021, this bill was passed and signed into law by Governor Inslee. It was designed to improve maternal outcomes and extend Medicaid coverage for a full 12 months after the end of the pregnancy. So Healthcare Authority created and named this new program after pregnancy coverage, and it was implemented in June of 2022. There was an educational campaign and outreach that was funded and required with the goal to ensure that everyone was educated about the eligibility and about the opportunity for this expanded coverage. So currently, individuals who are pregnant and on an Apple Health program are automatically eligible for 12 months of postpartum coverage through the After Pregnancy Coverage Program. The transition to APC, that's what we refer to it as, is automatic as long as there's an estimated due date reported during the pregnancy. The APC coverage begins the first day of the following month that the pregnancy ends, that is regardless of the pregnancy outcome. And that coverage is in effect for 12 months and is not impacted by changes in income or household size. If you're interested in more information about APC, you can visit hca.wa.gov/APC. Next slide. Thank you. And then talking more about APC, individuals who are not on Apple Health during their pregnancy may apply for after pregnancy coverage as long as they meet the following requirements. They need to have had a pregnancy that ended within the previous 12 months. They need to reside in Washington state, have that countable income equal to or below 193%. But again, remember that that income level is increasing to 210%, and not be active on any other Apple Health programs. There is no immigration status requirement for this program. And again, coverage begins the month the individual applies and is found eligible, so there's no waiting period. Next slide. All right, it is very exciting. So the program itself is not limited. It's a comprehensive Medicaid coverage, and the benefit package mirrors services that are covered during pregnancy. And that includes physical health, behavioral health, dental services, hospital services, inpatient and outpatient, maternity support services, and that is available up to 60 days post end of pregnancy. So if you'd like to learn more about the covered services available, we do have that link available as well. All right, so we kind of like to talk a little bit about the impact of after pregnancy coverage. So there is an evaluation in process confounded by the PHE and continuous enrollment through May of 2023. So the evaluation is reliant on data claims maturity. The evaluation and design and the analytic approach, looking at eligibility and how individuals are being enrolled in the program, and then also service utilization. So what is being accessed in that year post the end of pregnancy, along with the cost. Just some early or preliminary suggestions. The eligible population is currently showing low utilization of services, which is lower than what we anticipated when looking at the comparison group. Next slide, please. We are requesting for a wide partnership. So any of you who work with, support, or have any intersection with Apple Health clients, we are asking that you help us encourage clients to report their EDD when they are pregnant to HCA. So again, that's one of those requirements. They need to report that pregnancy and that end of pregnancy date in order to be eligible for the program. And also to our prenatal care providers and teams, just hoping that we can work together to inform and educate and give warm handoffs to primary care providers when clients are discharged from their pregnancy care to help ensure that continuity of care as they move forward in their post-pregnancy journey. All right, so we can now talk a little bit about family planning only coverage. We have a social media toolkit now available. So this is, again, talking about the family planning only coverage that is still a program and still available that covers testing, treatment, and vaccines for sexually transmitted diseases, as well as family planning services. And so hoping that if you are a social media person, you'll help us spread the word that family planning only is still available. The social media toolkit provides posts that can be used. There's access to images, key messages, and then also translations in Spanish. All right, let's highlight the voices of Apple Health. We really enjoy receiving stories from Apple Health recipients to hear about how Apple Health has impacted their lives. So we would introduce you to Gloria, whose family receives routine care visits with no financial stress. We know that that can have a big burden for families, and to be able to access that because of Apple Health is such a great opportunity. And then Jasmine shares her story about how CHIP health coverage has helped keep her daughter happy and healthy. If you know of anyone who might be willing to share their Apple Health story with us, they may be eligible for a $50 gift card if we publish their story. So for more information, visit hca.wa.gov/voices-apple-health for more information. Next slide, please. Okay, we would like to leave you with some resources. We have a Welcome to Washington Apple Health video series. HCA has released the next Apple Health video series that is created to complement the Welcome to Washington Apple Health Benefits booklet. There is a link to the client's specific booklet that is shared at the time of approval for Apple Health through their Provider One enrollment notice. And these videos are designed to help clients learn about their health coverage, but in short segments, and intended to reach a broader audience and take into consideration everyone's different learning styles. In 2023, we launched Find Out If You're Eligible and How to Apply for Apple Health Coverage. This year, we brought Understanding Your Apple Health Coverage to the masses, and we are looking forward to 2025, where we will release the How to Use Your Apple Health Coverage video. And those videos can be found at hca.wa.gov/AH4U. Next slide, please. If you have events coming up, whether they're in person or virtual, and you would like HCA to attend, please drop us an email, ahcommunications@hca.wa.gov, and we will work to provide support for your event. Next slide, please. The cross-agency desk aid is an extremely helpful tool for those of you who work closely with clients and field a lot of questions and have to do a lot of triaging. Highly recommend checking out the cross-agency desk aid. It is updated periodically, so if you've had it for a while, you might check for an updated version. It provides contact information for DSHS, HCA, HBE, OIC, and some other additional support agencies, and just really want to encourage utilizing that. You can take a look at it, kind of figure out what you're trying to accomplish, and find the correct referral resources. Next slide, please. Social media. We love our social media at HCA. We do have a presence on the most popular platforms. If you are a social media person, please follow us. We share a lot of fun information and a lot of important updates through our social media. We have found it's a very effective tool to reach people. So please feel free to follow us and share posts as you see fit, and help us continue to spread the word about Apple Health. One more plug for GovDelivery. GovDelivery, again, is just another great way to stay connected to all things Apple Health. And we do have the link available for you to subscribe. A few more resources. Again, just some information about our Apple Health eligibility policy team. That link will take you to a page that provides the email address I gave you at the beginning of the presentation. We do still have our community-based specialists out there. So if you have questions and you need some answers, really, really encourage you to utilize those amazing resources that are in your communities. Also, again, with the stakeholder and training page, here you'll find webinars, presentations, resource guides, all kinds of really helpful information that may answer a lot of questions that you have from day to day. And then also we have a link directly to our reference guides that provide very good information about our programs and services. So definitely check that one out as well. And then just like to open it up if there are any other questions. I saw Melissa maybe on dropping some information in the chat. So thank you so much for that.
Yeah, thank you, Shani. Always great to have you here. And yes, thank you to everyone who has been dropping links in the chat. It has been super helpful. But of course, yeah, if folks have any questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. And yeah, hopefully we'll get those answered and follow up with you on those.
All right. Thank you so much.
Yep. All right. And so now is the time in our meeting where we will hear from some of our meeting sponsors. So we have Shandy Daly here with us, and we'll be sharing some information about coordinated care.
Don't feel rushed. Go ahead and kick me to the next meeting. Because I've got an 11:30 hard stop, so please, my friends over at Coordinated Care, take your time, y'all. Don't worry about me.
Oh, thank you, David. well, good morning, everyone. Shandy Daly, Manager of Community Relations here at Coordinated Care, and just want to thank you for giving us the opportunity to share some updates today. Next slide. We are the sole healthcare provider for the youth in and out-of-home placement for foster care with our Apple Health 4 Connections plan. However, we are also a health plan choice for the entire household. So whether an individual or family is looking for a managed care plan through Apple Health, or for those who make a little bit over the limit to qualify for Apple Health, or are shopping for a qualified health plan on the health benefit exchange, we have our Ambiter from Coordinated Care plans. And for those who qualify for Medicare, we have our Medicare Advantage plan, WellCare. And I'm happy to announce that in 2025, we will be statewide for all health plan choices. So for those who are already in with Coordinated Care in a county that didn't previously have Ambiter or WellCare, we have expanded across the state for continuity of care. So as we head into open enrollment, our team will be sharing an in-depth presentation on benefits and plan offerings during Carrier Week. Today, we're just going to highlight some of our value-added benefits and updates. Next slide. Coordinated Care Harvest Bucks. So this is a value-added benefit we launched in 2021 to address food insecurity. And I know many of you may already know about this benefit, but we wanted to bring this to light for awareness in hopes that 100% of our members take full advantage of this benefit. All of our members get 10 of these $10 vouchers, regardless of age and household total. So they get 10 of these $10 vouchers they can use to purchase fruits and vegetables at Safeway. So if there was a family of 3 to 5, they get $30 to $50 for 10 months each month. These are very easily accessible. All of our members, all they have to do is either call our customer service line or email to request these here. So our foodrx at coordinatedcarehealth.com. Just wanted to note that these are stackable and they work with complete eats and SNAP benefits. Next slide. Our My Health Pays reward. So also one of our value-added benefits, it's a reward card. And we're excited to announce that last December, we made significant changes to this program to allow our members more opportunities to earn rewards by completing healthy activities. So once a healthy activity is completed, Next slide will depict those activities. An invoice from the doctor triggers the reward, and so there is no additional paperwork for our member to complete. Their first reward a member earns is when they will receive this card. And this card can be used to purchase everyday items at Walmart, used to pay their utility bills, transportation, childcare, just to name a few. This card may not be used to buy alcohol, tobacco, or firearm products. They do expire 90 days after termination of insurance coverage or 365 days after the date reward was earned, whichever comes first. Next slide. So this is the chart of healthy activities that our members can complete during the year. So we did increase the annual well visit to $40 a year. Annual flu shot is $25. And I do want to point out that we've added prenatal visits. So our members will get $50 total for the year, $25 for their initial visit, plus $5 per visit up to 5 additional visits. And then a postpartum visit. So once they complete a postpartum follow-up visit, they'll get $25. And then we did add behavioral health follow-up after hospitalization within the first 30 days of discharge, and that's for ages 6 and up. For breast cancer screening, we did add for ages 40 and up. I believe we might be the only MCO that is covering for ages 40 and up. And then our comprehensive diabetes screening, if they complete all 3 screenings, they get $40 added. So a total of $200 a member can earn throughout the year. Next slide. Our maternity programs, didn't want to highlight our Start Smart for Baby program. Our members do get a breast pump, but they also get a choice between a car seat, pack and play, or stroller. If they complete a notice of pregnancy form, they can log into their coordinated care account, or they'll get a pregnancy notice of pregnancy form through the mail. And this just lets us know to connect the member to our Start Smart for Baby program. Notice of pregnancy forms must be completed at least 6 weeks prior to their due date. And our Start Smart for Baby program helps to assure that our member is receiving care and that they have connected to other resources. One of our newest supports, I want to say programs, is our Healthy Beginnings program. It's a support for substance or opioid use disorder during and after pregnancy. Next slide. Our community education team is happy to offer you and your staff trainings at no cost on topics shown here and some others. Our team can provide the trainings in person or via webinars. And here is their email and how to connect for those trainings. Again, these are free trainings. Next slide. Want to talk about our active community involvement. Next slide. So coordinated care is committed to communities across the state. Over the last 4 years, we have reinvested over $7.8 million to community and provider partners across Washington, addressing 3 areas: social drivers of health, which is food insecurity, education, transportation, and housing needs partners; equity, addressing healthcare disparities, inequities among BIPOC, LGBTQ+, incarcerated, foster care, and other underrepresented populations; and then capacity building when it comes to healthcare workforce shortages and barriers to care. Next slide. We believe and we are committed to partnering because we recognize that it's a team effort. What you're seeing here are some of our community partners and recipients of our community giving programs. I did want to call out some of our partner, our food partners, like Second Harvest, because we recently launched a pilot this year where we collaborated with Second Harvest to host market resource fairs in Spokane and Tri-Cities. So the community was able to come and pick up food boxes of fresh produce and some shelf-stable items for their families while having access to resources from some of our community partners like Chaz and Tri-Cities Community Health. Fair Start, we're co-hosting a monthly mobile market with our partners at HealthPoint in King County, where their clients, our members, and the community are able to shop for fresh produce with vouchers that we sponsor. And then we're hosting our first ever market resource fair with Northwest Harvest and OIC in Yakima this October with some of our partners like Yakima Valley Farm Workers Clinic. And we're so excited. The idea of this mobile market or market resource fair started back in 2022 when we launched our very first market resource fair with our partners at Metro Parks Tacoma in Pierce. We were trying to figure out, you know, how do we address food insecurity and difficulties with access to resources? And, you know, what better way to get the community together to shop for free produce and visit resource tables all under one roof? So free market resource fairs were definitely something that came about, and we continue this twice a year in Pierce County. So super excited for all of our partnerships across the state. Next slide. And then all that to say that over the last four years, our collective efforts have helped provide over 50 million meals through employee volunteer opportunities, financial supportive programs, providing food and meals to communities across the state, and our partnerships with food agencies across the state as well. Next slide. And then here is our slide of or map of our community relations team. This is the main point of contact with any questions related to any of our plans or benefits, whether it be for Apple Health, our marketplace plan, our welfare plan. And then these are also Navigator's main point of contact as well, and our community-based organization. So please take note of the community relations coordinator for your region, and they can answer any questions that you may have. And so also want to say that this team is local and they live and work in the regions that they cover. And I'll leave you folks with that. So thank you all for all you do for the community and for our members. And thank you for having us today.
All right. I don't see any questions. But I want to say thank you, Shandy, for joining and sharing information about coordinated care. It was a pleasure having you with us here today. And so I know that for David had mentioned that they had another meeting to attend. So we will hear from WellPoint at our next WCOMO meeting. And so with that, we could go ahead and skip to the last slides. Oh, there you go. All right. And so, yeah, like I mentioned, we'll go ahead and have David join us for the next meeting to present and share information about WellPoint. And so, as mentioned earlier, we will be posting the presentation from today's meeting online. The link to find them will be posted in the chat box. And like we typically do, we do have a feedback survey. So we'll include that in the chat box as well. So you all are encouraged to fill that out. There are about 6 questions for our survey, and they are pretty much just used to help us improve these meetings. And so if we go to the next slide, if you have yet to connect with us on social media, here's all the information you need to do so. And with that, we can officially adjourn our September 2024 WCOMO. Again, a huge shout out to all those for being here. And thank you so much to all of the presenters for coming and sharing. And a big thank you to our sponsors for supporting these meetings as well. So happy Friday, everyone. Hope you have a great weekend, and we will see you in a few months.